quite a long time ago I published this circuit on my YouTube channel. It's a kind of pre-amplifier made with a PNP and an NPN transistor. This is the NPN transistor and this is the PNP. And one of my YouTube viewers made this circuit and connected it to a phone cartridge, crystal cartridge, to play vinyl records. And he told me that it didn't work. That was for me a reason to make it again, try it again, test it again. And here is that circuit again. And you see here that the capacitor of 4N7 4700 picofarad is optional, but I soldered in here a capacitor of 5N7, so 5700 picofarad. That was necessary to get a good waveform. Perhaps that was something that I had to tell earlier anyway. I think it's still a very good circuit and I don't know why it didn't work with that crystal cartridge for vinyl records. But anyway, a crystal phone element is in fact a quite typical element, kind of microphone to pick up signals, because it has an extremely high impedance, say in the mega ohms range, and it has a high output voltage, say 1 volt, 2 volt, or perhaps in extreme cases even 3 volts. And this circuit was only made for lower input voltages, AC input voltages, so it could be that with a crystal phone element, a crystal cartridge, there's a complete distortion here, etc., etc. The transistor is saturated with signal. So that could be one of the problems that he met when making this circuit. Anyway, I also had a small problem here. I had a defective potentiometer here in that first stage when I made this, and it cost me, say, approximately an hour or 1.5 hours to find that out. I couldn't get a good waveform, etc., etc., but that's also important. Use a good property potentiometer here. This resistor protects the base current when this resistor is not here, and you align the bias here, you do that here, the biasing. When you align it to the most positive part and this resistor is not present, your transistor burns out immediately. Within a few seconds, not a few seconds, say 1/100 of a second. So this is the whole circuit, and I tested it and it works very properly between, say, 20 Hz and say 350 kHz and even higher, no problem. This is the filter capacitor. So in fact there's not so much more to tell about that circuit. So let's look at the practical circuit here. You see the bias potentiometer. I always talk about in my earlier videos about the working point of the transistor, and I know now that it's more or less common to call that biasing, but anyway the working point is where the transistor is set to, and that can be a nonlinear part of the transistor properties or a linear part. And when it's set to a linear part, the waves that are sent in into the transistor are amplified properly, and then I mean in terms of amplifying the positive part of the wave and the negative part of the wave. And when a transistor is set to the non-linear mode, it can act as a switch. That's often done with applications where the transistor has to switch something, be it a coil or a speaker or whatever. Now it's all set to 35 Hertz, the waveform on 35 Hertz. And here I show what happens when we change the biasing of the first transistor. You can see that it doesn't work any longer. When I turn that potentiometer to other values anyway. Here's the sine wave oscillator. And let's see what happens when we change the input frequency from 35 Hertz to higher frequencies. Now we are on 100 Hertz. I have to align the scope, the time base of the scope. Sorry, 100 Hertz. Switch to the next frequency band. We are now on approximately 1000 Hertz. Of course, I have to align the scope again, the time base, 1000 Hertz. 10,000 Hertz. And with this way of testing, you can get a good insight about how good such a simple two-transistor amplifier works and whether it creates distortion or not. There's no distortion visible here on 10 kilohertz. So up to 100 kilohertz. And you can also see that the amplification is quite linear over the complete band. We see here three points, and they are exactly the same when you go from, say, 20 Hertz up to 100 kilohertz. Align the time base somewhat to show how that waveform looks like. Perhaps there is somewhat distortion, but that's not relevant for almost all purposes. And now to the highest frequency of my sine wave generator. And here we see some distortion. So let's align the biasing, see whether that works, whether it can help to solve this problem. No, that doesn't help anyway. So let's go back to the frequency, the highest frequency that this circuit can handle, and it is 380 kilohertz. So I think a quite good result. Of course, it's a good idea to change the value of this capacitor. Perhaps with other values you can get to higher frequencies with no or low distortion. That was more or less all to tell. Pan over somewhat to see this, all these beautiful electronic components. Always test the amplification factor of the transistors that you use. When you buy them on flea markets, it could be that their amplification is too low, but also that their amplification is too high. And that's a serious problem. These transistors were ejected often out of the industrial process because of their too high amplification factor, and that can also mean that they can get very easily defective. I tested it out. I bought approximately 400 BC547 transistors for say 5 euros. I've tested them all, thrown all the transistors with a too high amplification factor away, and after that I even found that when I made circuits with all the transistors that stayed over, that were good on the meter, they proved to be very sensitive and they could be easily damaged. So when you want to have to take no risks, of course buy them, all these transistors from good manufacturers, good brands, etc. And in that case you can be sure that the properties of the transistors meet the specifications from the manufacturer.